All right. Okay, well that's goodbye the demand curve. Rather, the demand curve is, you can. The good news about the last half of the lecture, by the way, is you can actually draw a demand curve, starting from utility maximising individuals. Just it looks rather wobbly. But let's now pretend the actual market demand curve actually looks the way the neoclassicals want it to be. It actually slopes downwards. We know that isn't the case. But even if it is the case, then the supply curve doesn't work the way they want it to do. And the core message here is its market supply curve is just as invalid as the demand curve. In fact, worse in some ways. At least the market demand curve exists. You can prove that the market demand curve, the market supply curve doesn't exist. So, of course, what I'm doing here, to some extent, is attacking the realism. I'm not actually attacking the realism of the theory in this part of the course, because I did when I took a look at simples and say it's not realistic to model people's behaviour that way, but and then I said even if it was realistic, you can't get a downsloping market demand curve. I'll also take a look at the realism of the theory later, but a major defence that neoclassical economists make against people who criticise them is saying, oh, you want us to have realistic assumptions, do you? Okay, we're going to assume that maps, therefore, have to include the colour of the grass as you go past. Otherwise, they're not valid, you know. And they're saying, we've got to assume there's no grass on the side of the road. So they say realism doesn't matter. And the first person to make that case vehemently was Milton Friedman. And his argument about this was, but he's saying that a lot of people criticise the realism of the theory of the supply curve by saying, look, firms, when we go and ask them what they do, they don't work out what marginal cost and marginal revenue are. They don't do the calculus. And Friedman says, well, it doesn't matter, because if no matter what they do, if that didn't coincide with equating marginal cost and marginal revenue, they wouldn't be profit maximisers. So saying we don't need to worry about what they actually do, because what they actually do has to conform to this, otherwise they won't maximise profits. So it's the as-if defence. And what he was actually telling people to do was don't bother reading a whole lot of papers which are being published right now that are doing surveys about how firms actually behave and coming out and saying firms don't look like you think they do and don't behave the way you think they do. Now, in fact, the major thing they were talking about was the shape of the marginal cost curve. He didn't address that at all. He's just saying here that they've got to be still equating marginal cost and marginal revenue. Now, in his defence, he included an analogy with billiard players. And that's saying that if you wanted to work out what a billiard player was going to do, then you could easily say, well, let's get Newton's equations of motion and work out the mathematics of where you strike the cue against the cue ball and which way that's going to make it spin and which direction it will then follow and where it's going to hit the target ball and where that'll bounce to, and you'll be accurate. But he said, we know that's not how billiard players actually do it. None of them sit there and calculate Newton's equations to work out how to sink a ball. Now, we know they don't do that, but unless they did, they wouldn't win pool tournaments. So it's quite a good argument in that sense, you know. They might not think they're doing it, but if that's not what they're actually doing, they won't sink the ball. He said it's only a small step from that example to the argument that firms behave as if they knew the cost functions, they calculated marginal cost and marginal revenue, and they pushed output until the two are equal. So he's saying, don't need to worry about those other academic papers, ignore them. So even though they don't consciously set marginal cost equal to marginal revenue, unless they do that, they won't maximise profits. Okay? That was said in 1953, a long time ago, and before we had computers. Of course, now we've got computers. We can actually test ideas like Friedman's by setting up a mathematical situation in the computer that's got the market, a textbook market demand curve and textbook firm. But the firms here, I'm taking Milton's case here, I'm not going to make these firms do calculus. I'm just assuming the firms what I call instrumentally rational profit maximizers. And what they do is they choose some output level at random. They choose some amount to vary output by also at random. Then they vary their output. And if they happen to have chosen to increase their output by, say, 30 units, and they do that and profit rises, then the next production round they increase by another 30 units. If, on the other hand, they find their profit falls, then they reduce production by 30 units next time round. That's all they're doing. Now, you can't get much, inverted commas, dumber than that, okay? You're not doing any calculus here. You just suck it and see what profit maximises profits. Now, the question is, do they behave as Milton says they do? Do they set, by what their behaviour is, do they end up setting marginal cost equal to marginal revenue? Well, here's the model. I start with textbook supply and demand curves. So I've got price being a downward sloping function of market quantity, and it's a straight linear demand curve. And I've got marginal cost rising quadratically. So you've got a parabola describes marginal cost. And marginal revenue is easy to calculate from that from the demand curve. And I use big parameter values. Those parameters give me really serious numbers because I get very annoyed at textbook examples that have like Mankiw had a perfect competitive, I think it was a lemonade producing plant producing 14 units. You know, give me a break. Let's talk about serious quantities. So I use A at 800 and B at 1 over 10 million, and that therefore gives me a very large quantity as the equilibrium output for a monopoly, and of course divided amongst 100 firms if there's 100 in the industry. Now the theory predicts this outcome. And these curves you see now are not drawings. Virtually everything you'll see in a neoclassical textbook is a drawing. Some graphic artist was asked to draw a few curves together. If you actually sat down and worked out whether what they call the marginal cost curve actually is the slope of the total cost, average cost curve, you'd find the variable cost curve, you'd find that it wasn't. Okay? They never draw curves that are actually mathematically accurate. These are mathematically accurate. So there's the demand curve, there's marginal revenue, there's marginal cost, and you can see that's the square that they say would be the amount that a monopoly will produce, and there's what a competitive industry of 100 firms. And I've actually set it up so that's exactly the amount that neoclassical theory says 100 firms who equate marginal cost and marginal revenue would produce. Now I can test it with a computer program where I've got this artificial industry with those demand and supply functions that you see there, and I start with one firm and see what the one firm bounces to, and then two and three and four out to 100 firms. So the program that does it looks like this. We've got a couple of programmers down here in the front row. Does anybody else know how to program? Write a computer program. Okay. This is written in a language called MathCAD. I do almost all my work in a mathematics program called MathCAD. And I use this programming tools as well. So what this program does is says, I start with a monopoly. That first line there says for I equal to the minimum number of firms out to the maximum number of firms, and I start at 1 and go out to 100. I start with an initial randomly chosen output level, and that output level is for each firm. So it's randomly chosen between the prediction that neoclassical theory makes that a firm in that industry will produce out to the amount that I say they'll produce, which is different. Then given that initial price, you add up all the initial quantity, you add up the amounts being produced by each firm, feed that into the market demand curve, you get a market price. Then after that, each firm chooses an amount to vary its output by, again at random. It can be up, it can be down. Each firm's got a different amount they vary their output by. And then for a large number of iterations, so I do about 1,000 runs here. So each time I do it, one output level, second, third, fourth, out to 1,000 to see what they converge to over time. You start off by varying the amount being produced by adding the change in amount for each firm to the amount they started with, and that then gives you an aggregate amount which is different to the previous time period or simulation period. You feed that into the price equation for demand, work out a new market price, and then every firm individually works out whether their profit has risen or fallen. If the profit rises, they keep on moving in the same direction. If the profit reverses, they change the sign of the amount they're changing the amount by. So it was positive and profit was, which means they're increasing output, and profit went up, it stays positive. If it's positive and profit went down, it changes to negative. That's all they do. Then see what happens. So I start with one firm, vary away, iterate through 1,000 cycles. What I'm looking for is where does the amount converge to, and does it fit the neoclassical prediction that it'll be a low amount for monopoly, rising as more firms are added to the system. And this is what the theory predicts. The basic idea, the more firms, the higher the output and the lower the price, and in particular, monopoly output is less and price higher than a competitive industry. And using 100 firms pretty much converges to the amount they'd say you'd get with an infinite number of firms. So that does me. So there's the predictions. What I predict is there'll be the same output level for the industry regardless of how many firms there are in the industry. And here we go, let's take a look at it. This is a simulation showing you the total amount being produced, my prediction, and the classical prediction for a 100 firm industry. The blue line is the aggregate. The little bouncing ones are the individual amounts of about 10 firms. The triangle line is my prediction, which is lower than the neoclassical prediction, which is the dotted one up above. So with 100 firms, my prediction wins. Neoclassical prediction loses. Not what the textbook tells you. Well, maybe the thing is firms aren't profit maximising. Milton said if they don't equate marginal cost and marginal revenue, they won't maximise profits. So maybe my firms are making a lower profit somehow. Their randomness isn't as good as doing the calculus. Let's check that. I'm now going to look at the profit they earn. Again, the triangle is my prediction. I predict a higher profit for these firms by not doing what neoclassical theory tells you to do. And notice the neoclassical predictions down the bottom now, a lower level of profit. If you look at my firms, they get a huge range. One's making less profit than the neoclassical prediction, but all the others are making more, and the aggregate is way up here. So I've got two outcomes out of that. First of all, my instrumentally rational profit-maximising firms don't do what neoclassical theory says they do. And secondly, they make a higher profit. There's something really, really wrong in here. What's going on? So they don't equate marginal cost and marginal revenue, and they make higher profits. And there's no difference between a competitive industry and a monopoly. So that's the theory's predictions again. Notice there's the monopoly output is a higher price and a lower quantity than the competitive. That's what I get. They overlap with each other. So the number of firms has no impact on market price. That's now showing you for between zero firms and 100 firms in the industry. The blue line is my prediction. The black line is what I got from that particular experimental run. The red line is the neoclassical prediction. It's right for one firm. It's wrong from that point on. And prices, again, higher. The price for a competitive industry is pretty much the same as a monopoly. It's the same as roughly the same there as a three-firm industry. It's actually higher than the outputs you got for those up to 20 firms. And there's no collusion going on, because if you take a look at what actually happens with a few firms taken at random out of an industry with 100 firms in it, the neoclassical prediction for the output level's up here, my prediction's down here, the black wiggly line is what the industry converges to over time, converges down to mine after 1,000 iterations, but the blue, I hope they're the same colours, yeah, blue, orange and red are three firms chosen at random and clearly not behaving the same way. I've had neoclassical journals reject this paper on the argument that there must be collusion going on between your agents. In fact, they've got to be doing exactly the same thing. No, they're not. Very different. And yet, of course, again, they make a higher profit. So those three firms, again, as I've shown them, happen to make a higher profit than the average profit that I get, which is way above the neoclassical prediction. So something is seriously wrong here. And that is that equating marginal cost to marginal revenue does not maximise profits. Mathematical fallacy. And a demand curve for an individual firm can't be horizontal. Stuff you're taught in micro is provably false. And there's lots more to that. So let's go through them one by one. The individual firm curve can't be horizontal because of the assumptions of the model. Now, back when I was taught this stuff, I hate to say it, but 40 years ago, I did micro 40 years ago in first year. Dreadful thought. Still remember it. They said firms are atomistic. That's the term they used. They don't use it anymore, apparently. Have you heard that word before used to describe firms? What about being price takers? Price takers, that's what they use these days, okay. And they say, well, firms are atomistic or price takers. They simply take what's offered on the market and the market curve is downward sloping. That means, rather than getting a horizontal demand curve for the individual firm, the curve the individual firm sees will have exactly the same slope as the market demand curve. They make a logical error in thinking they can drive a horizontal demand curve in what they call price-taking behaviour. And the slope of the demand curve facing an individual firm is exactly the same as the market demand curve. Now, when I first worked this out, when I wrote the first edition of Debunking Economics back in 2000, I thought I was the first person to discover it. And I went checking the literature, and take a look at the date of the paper I'm now referring to, 1957. So this was proven in 1957. And it was proven in an extremely prestigious neoclassical journal by a top-ranking neoclassical economist, George Stigler. He was one of the most rabid defenders of neoclassical theory. Notice the title of the paper, Perfect Competition Historically Contemplated. The journal might look radical to you, but the Journal of Political Economy is a very old journal. Notice it was issued in 65, even in 1957. So it started back at in the 19th century. And it's one of the three or four leading neoclassical journals. Again, it's something people should have seen. And notice the page number. It's the very first issue that year, the very first page of the very first issue that year. Now, in footnote 31 of that paper, he said, we can actually take marginal revenue for the ith firm, that's the change in price times its quantity, divided by changes in its quantity, and we can expand that using the product rule, to price plus quantity multiplied by this term here. And notice what he's done. He's taken dp d little q, if I go horizontally there, and he said it's actually equal to dp d big q multiplied by d big q d little q. That's applying the chain rule at that point. And he then says dq, d big q d little q is 1. Now what that's saying is if all firms are price takers and don't interact with each other, then if one firm changes its output by, say, 5 units, at that instant, industry output will rise by 5 units. Now that therefore means that this whole expression is less than price, because that's a negative. dp dq is the slope of the market demand curve. Negative, that's 1. That's the output quantity of the ith firm. That will be less than price. They've got a downward sloping curve there. Now, again, this is a leading journal and a lead article by a lead author. So, again, the fact that it's not part of the literature is remarkable. And this guy fought to keep neoclassical theory out of the literature and attack people who criticise neoclassical theory. So it's amazing that people, the neoclassicals, most of them, don't know this result either. Now, the graphical intuition is fairly obvious. If you have a large downward sloping curve and you take a small segment of it, that small segment's going to have the same slope as the big bit. So if I start with P and Q, and then choose Q plus big delta Q, and have P minus delta P, and then choose little Q, and little Q plus delta Q, there's going to be a gap. And the line that I can draw to join those two will have the same slope as the overall line. So I can then say that little delta P, little delta Q, is going to be the same as big delta P, big delta Q. That's the graphical intuition. Now, you're also told they can act as if the demand curve is horizontal. Well, sure they can, but then they're being irrational. Because if you actually draw the demand curve for the ith firm and start with it producing 0 units and then see what it produces, say, at QI level, then it's going to start at P of Q. This up here is going to be P of Q plus QI. Now, however small QI might be compared to big Q, it's a larger number. Therefore, the price for P of Q plus QI is going to be less than the price of P of Q. So the firm behaves as if it's exactly the same. They're being irrational. Now, you don't get told that firms are irrational profit maximizers, do you? You're told they're rational profit maximizers. The whole problem is neoclassical theory has equated an infinitesimal amount with a zero. And that's the fundamental mistake in calculus. So how do they get that result? They show you textbooks that look like it works. And what they apply is a simple little thing called magic. And I'm going to use the same trick. I'm going to visually zoom in on the horizontal axis while leaving the vertical axis at full range. And that flattens the line. Do it often enough, you get a flat line out of a downward sloping one. So there's a downward sloping line. And notice the vertical dotted lines here. I'm going to take a slice through that bit. So I'm choosing this tiny bit of quantity, which is more relevant for a single firm, but looking at the entire market price. So I zoom in there, and I get that. Getting flat already. Let's repeat the process. Now I'm taking this segment, zooming in on there, bug over here, hey, horizontal line. Simple. What if you do the other way of zooming in on both axes? Then it remains downward sloping. Now I'm going around that box. I zoom in on that box. What do I get? Hey, downward sloping. Do it again. Take that box. Zoom in there. I get that. Do it again. I get that. I'm now getting down to a quantity that's relevant to a single firm, and the firm is seeing a downward sloping line. So back to the assumed price-taking behaviour. Assume you can sell as much as it likes at the market price. Again, yeah, you can, but you're talking irrationality. So no matter how much it slopes down by, any amount that the firm adds to output will cause market price to fall. So that's the rational belief. That is irrational. So neoclassical theory depends upon irrational behaviour. I've actually shown I can get the neoclassical result if I have enough irrational profit minimisers in my model. If I throw in a number of people who, when the profit goes up, when they increase output, they then reduce output, doing the opposite of what will maximise, then I get the neoclassical result. So we've got marginal revenues less than price. The demand curve isn't horizontal for a single firm. So you've been taught a fallacy for 40 years. Now, the question is, can that fallacy be justified? Because again, notice the same thing applied with the demand curve, calling what's actually a contradiction, stringent conditions. Well, Stigler said in 1957 that it could. And he was right. What he did was, he took that marginal revenue term for the I... What they wanted to have is marginal revenue for the I firm be equal to price. Now, he showed straight away it's not. But then he said, if you add enough firms, it will converge over time. This is what he did. So he took the argument that this is what a profit maximizer does. So he said marginal revenue equal to marginal cost. And he said, well, let's take marginal revenue and modify it and see if we can make it the same as price. So he introduced P over P and Q over Q into the last term. So he hasn't changed anything so far, multiplied by 1. Then he said QI is Q divided by N. So he gets rid of one of the Qs and brings in an N inside there as well as QI. That's the next stage. Now he says, let's rearrange the P's and Q's. Rather cute, isn't it? What's your P's and Q's? Expression for grammar. Rearranges them, and he says that whole expression becomes like P times 1 over N times Q over P, and what that finally looks like is this. Why on earth has he done all that? Well, it's because he wants to get this last little set of terms here, those two terms together, because that is the inverse of the market elasticity of demand. Have you done elasticity calculations? Well, that's E. So you said if you actually write it that way, we can now rewrite that first equation. So you can say marginal revenue for the I firm is price plus price divided by N multiplied by E, where N is the number of firms in the economy, in the industry. And he said this last term goes to zero as the number of firms rises. Therefore, you add more and more firms to output, marginal revenue will converge to price, and that gets rid of the problem. Therefore, we can justify not really telling students this because, you know, perfect competition, 10 or 20 firms, you converge, no problem, nothing wrong. And he's right, that's true. There's nothing wrong with that mathematics. There's only one problem with the whole thing. Equating marginal cost and marginal revenue does not maximise profits. So the neoclassical argument is that if you equate your marginal cost to your marginal revenue, you'll maximise your profits. That's all we need to do. That mathematically says you've got to solve an ordinary differential, not a differential equation, but an ordinary differential, where you find the derivative of your profit relative to your output and set that to zero, and then you find the maximum level of your profit. But in the real world, in the model as well, profits don't just depend on what you do. It also depends what other firms do. Whether you know what those firms are doing and whether or not you can control them. What they do will affect the profit you can make. The analogy I often use, like, is if it's saying, I want to get from this side of the river to another side of the river, so I'm going to swim across the river, ignoring the current. Well, you might end up going over the edge of a waterfall rather than getting where you want to go, even though you can't control the water. So the real profit maximising rule is actually a total differential. If you want to work out what really maximises your profits, you've got to find where the derivative of your profit relative to the total output of the industry is zero. Now, I get told again, firms can't know that. Well, as I've just shown you, even doing suck it and see trial and error stuff, firms actually find the formula I'm going to show you. You don't need to do calculus to do it. But it's actually possible to do the calculus. And I give a little analogy here. Imagine you have a capitalist who tells a couple of staff to work out the output level that maximises his profits. But one thing I love about this graphic, by the way, that is almost a spitting image of Kerry Packer, Jamie Packer's dad. And 30 years ago, or like more than 30 years ago, I took a bunch of journalists to China, one of whom worked for Kerry Packer. And he told me when he got back home, if Kerry bumped him in the corridor, he'd say, how was China, Andrew? And Andrew would say, oh, it's pretty interesting, Kerry. And his next question will be, can I make a buck out of it? He said, if I tell Kerry at that stage, no, mate, you can't, he'd shrug his shoulders and walk off down the corridor. But if I said, yes, you can, he had me against the wall drilling me for 4 hours about how. So definitely somebody wants to maximise his profits. So you ask an economist to do it, and the economist says, that's easy. All I've got to do is work out the marginal cost and marginal revenue curves and equate the two, and boom, I can tell you how to maximise your profits, how many copies of Clio you have to sell. Anybody watch that story about Clio, by the way? Brilliant, I thought. Really worth what the paper, was it called Paper Giants? Brilliant show. There's another one coming along shortly, which Channel 9 has bought, I believe. A mathematician gets set the same problem. He says, oh, that's an interesting problem. What I've got to do is work out the total derivative and set that to zero. So we now see what they both do. Now, I'll give the actual mathematics at the end of the lecture, but I'll go through a verbal explanation now, first of all. The total differential says, find where the change in total revenue minus total cost is zero relative to the change in Q, big Q. And that means you've got to find where that expression is equal to zero. Now, I'll do the mathematics later. The neoclassicals use an ordinary one where they say you have to work out this once for one firm only. That's all they solve. Now, those two equations are going to give you very different results. So the total differential involves working out something like the neoclassical term, but for each firm in the industry and then adding up the sum. So notice what I've got here. This partial derivative sign says I want to find the derivative of revenue for the I firm, revenue minus costs, given change in output by the J firm. And then I need to add that up for all the firms in the industry. That's the change in the ith firm's profit given a change by the jth firm in its output. Now, one time in going through all that sum, we're going to have I equal to J, which is what the neoclassicals do only once up here. Now, I do it n times for all the firms in an n firm industry. Now, using the product rule, I can expand that revenue component. So that looks much like what you see for the, you know, for the revenue function, only includes how much. This is price multiplied by how much the output of the ith firm changes given a change in output by the jth firm. That's something that comes in from the fact that I'm doing a total differential rather than just an ordinary. And then I've got qi times how much market price changes given a change in output by the jth firm. That's market price times how much a given firm's change in output changes your own output, summed over the n firms in the industry. Now that is going to be zero n minus one times, because you don't change your output when another firm changes its output. You might change later in the iterative game I showed you beforehand, but you don't do it instantaneously. Therefore that is equal to zero n minus one times and equal to one once when you're looking at how much your output changes when you change your output. The ratio is one. That reduces to P. The second bit is your output times how much market price changes given a change in output by a given firm. Now, as we've seen from Stigler's relationship, that's the market demand, the slope of the market demand curve. So each time you look at it, I'm going to get that term, QI times DPDQ, where that's DPDQ is the market demand curve. So I'm going to get N copies of QI times the slope of the market demand curve. So overall, the cost component, that's the next bit, the cost component is how much your cost change given an output by the J firm. Now again, for N minus 1 times, it's going to be zero, because your costs don't get affected by what other firms do. But one time, it's going to be your marginal cost. So maximum profit occurs where you equate P plus N times the output of the I firm times DPDQ minus the marginal cost of producing that output equals zero. What the neoclassical formula tells you to do is it's at P plus QI times DPDQ equal to minus marginal cost equal to zero. They're missing an N. And that therefore means they recommend a much higher output level, because that's a negative term. You need a much higher output level to make the whole thing equal to zero. So what we have as a theory of the firm is something that's incoherent, just as bad as the demand curve stuff. And the whole distinction between perfect competition and monopoly is based on a mathematical fallacy. Once you remove the fallacy, there's no advantage of competitive firms over monopolies. And in fact, it's quite possible that you'll get a better result from monopoly, according to neoclassical theory. Now, it also shows that rational profit-maximising behaviour is incompatible with welfare maximisation. And that is not a criticism of capitalism. The whole idea that you can do something at zero cost is one of the delusions that economics has been infested by since neoclassical theory came along back in the 1800s. Because they thought you get perfect efficiency. Whole word perfect. Engineers, I've got two in the front row, I'm very pleased to say, ex-engineer, and both ex-engineers now, I suppose, learn what's called the second law of thermodynamics. And that tells you there's no such thing as a perfectly efficient engine. The only way you can get a perfectly efficient engine is if you dump the waste heat from the engine into a void which is at absolute zero, 270 degrees below zero degrees Celsius. So engineers know there's no such thing as a perfect engine. Work involves waste. Okay? Economists think they can have a market which has no waste, which is nonsense. Now, there's a more complicated version of the theory you won't learn in undergraduate, you will learn in honours or PhD, and that's called the Cournot-Nash game theoretic approach that gets better competition, but I've also shown how that can be disproved. Mathematically, it's not false, but its actual assumptions about behaviour are false in the sense that it works for a one-off shot if you only do it once, but it doesn't work if you do it more than once. And then I can then show that if you have two firms who are not colluding, they will then move away from the Nash equilibrium towards my equilibrium. So the welfare results get turned up on the head. For a start, perfect competition, if it existed, would price at the same level as monopoly. There's no advantage over having lots of small firms. And profit maximisation is incompatible with welfare maximisation, and general equilibrium, which normally relies upon equating price to marginal cost, is invalid. And you can actually argue that monopoly is going to be better than competition under some circumstances. So the deadweight loss of monopoly is actually the deadweight loss from profit maximisation. But the worst thing for neoclassical theory is, as soon as you don't have perfect competition, you don't have a supply curve. And that's the part they don't actually teach you all that well in class, but it explains why they're so obsessed with perfect competition. This is taken from Mankiw's slides again. Remember, he draws a horizontal demand curve, it has marginal cost, and then shows that at each point, whatever the demand is going to be, drawing a horizontal line across to represent it, supply will be on the marginal cost curve. And then you aggregate those curves to get the upward sloping market supply curve. If you have instead a downward sloping demand curve, which you do have, marginal cost will differ. Price will differ from marginal revenue, and you won't get a supply curve because you can't independently draw a supply curve without knowing demand. To give you an illustration of that, let's say there's aggregate marginal cost there. And that's one demand curve and one marginal revenue curve. And there's price for monopolist, and actually for any firm structure now, as I've shown you. That's going to be P1 and Q1. Try a different demand curve, same marginal cost curve, that's the amount the industry is going to produce, competitive or a monopoly. And if I then join the two points together, that's the supply curve I get. Downward sloping. Not what you want. So you can't get the supply curve unless you have perfect competition as they define it, which is where you have horizontal demand curves for individual firms. So it's simply impossible to do supply and demand analysis. And that's why neoclassicals defend such an obscure idea as perfect competition so vigorously, because without it, they can't do supply and demand curve. So the aggregate position is like that. If this did describe markets, when I'll show next week or the week after it doesn't, then what they call the deadweight loss due to monopoly is actually just a deadweight loss due to profit maximisation. And that's just saying markets aren't perfectly efficient, just as car engines aren't. And again, if you get just on the whole case, this can't be a way of describing different firms, because if you look at what happens with monopoly versus a competitive industry, you can quite easily argue that normally a monopoly is going to have lower costs. Now, the best example I've been given of this is from an article in a journal that I published a paper on when I explained this mathematics, from somebody who is an expert in the gas industry. And she said that if you consider a gas field and you want to get the gas to a city, then if you have a monopoly, the monopoly can build one big pipe. If you have a competitive, you've got to have lots of small pipes being built. Now, the amount of energy you need to move gas through a pipe is proportional to its diameter. The smaller the diameter, the more force you need to move the same volume of gas. So a monopoly pump will be a big pump with lower energy output than lots of small pumps that would be needed to pump through a lot of small pipes. So the marginal cost for monopoly supply will be lower, and therefore in that case you could say there's a welfare gain due to monopoly. So it ain't good. The theory is a mess. We start with the definition of rational behaviour and find that it's empirically false, computationally impossible, and can't even be used to derive a market demand, even if it did work. And yet the neoclassical theory models the entire economy as a single agent, and supply theory doesn't work either. Now, for me, that's not rational. Whatever rationality is, it isn't what neoclassical economists call it, so we need a definition of rationality that makes sense. We certainly can't go around describing different behaviours as rational and irrational when this is what we serve up as a theory. And that definition of what rational behaviour is has to take account of computational issues as well. So I showed you in the last week, what we describe as behaviour has to be feasible to be done in finite time. And it can't evolve optimal behaviour. So what is rational behaviour is completely open. And I get onto that issue next week on what is rational behaviour. Now, I've got a bit of time here. Can you cope with going through the maths to show how I derived that, or should I give that a miss? Oh boy, it's a tough call, isn't it? Well, I'll put the maths up there because I can vandalise people on the web who look at this on YouTube. So we start with the whole idea, the same thing I've given you beforehand. You've got to set the zero, the total differential. That's what you've got to solve. Expand that out. I've now said it's, when I say what that is, it's the sum of those partial differentials over all J firms in the industry. And I've got to then look at also how the output of the J firm varies, the partial of delta little j to little q to big Q. And that's the sum over N firms, that's the profit term, that's the impact of the J firm's behaviour on the I firm's profit. And this last bit is one. We're working with atomism here again. Okay, it's just the upside down version of how much market output changes given a change in output by a single firm. So I can drop that firm out of the way. And I can now expand profit into total revenue minus total cost and look at the change in the two. So that's the rule for maximising profit for a single firm. Now the second bit is marginal cost once, as I've shown you, and n minus 1 times it's zero. So I can now expand that out and say that n term is marginal cost for the I firm. The first bit is a bit more complicated. I've got to now use the product rule to expand this out. So I've got price times quantity of the I firm expanded with respect to change in output for the J firm. So I now get this term, which involves the one I showed you beforehand, how much the I-th firm's output changes given a change in the J-th firm's output, plus QI times this term here. And N minus 1 times that first bit's going to be 0. So I'm going to get one copy of P. And N times, this is going to be dP dQ times N. What you finally get is the expression I've shown you. That's the profit maximising expression, whereas the conventional formula leaves the N out. And since the slope of the market demand curve is negative, the true profit maximising level is a lot less than the theory argues. Now, what that actually means is that the real marginal revenue for the I-th firm is actually closer to the market marginal revenue, as I've shown you from that formula, because N times QI, which I've got there, is roughly the same as Q, even if the firms are different in output levels. So the conventional formula is only going to be right for a monopoly. And the competitive profit maximising firms will produce the same amount at the same output given the same conditions. I'll give you an example of that. And I'm using constant marginal cost here just to make the maths easier to follow. But let's look at this. The standard advice is equate marginal revenue for the I-th firm to marginal cost. And output will then converge to perfect competition, as Stigler showed. So let's start with these conditions. I've got price being a downward sloping function of quantity, and I've got marginal cost just being a constant. So I can now say, well, here's the neoclassical formula. It says equate marginal revenue for the I firm, which is P minus B times Q, to marginal cost. And I then get A minus B times Q, do a substitution, and I finally get the amount the competitive firm is going to produce is going to be 1 over N plus 1 times A minus C over B, and a monopoly is going to produce 1 half for the N plus 1 there, whereas competition is going to produce N times that much, which goes out to being A minus C over B. So the competitive firm produces, industry produces twice as much, according to the neoclassicals. But that's what profit maximizers are actually solving. I can rearrange the formula I showed you to say rather than equating marginal cost and marginal revenue for the I firm, they should make the gap between them equal to N minus 1 over N, well, that's the number of firms in the industry, times price minus marginal cost. So if you put that formula in, go through the same expansions, I finally get that the amount the I firm should produce is going to be 1 half A minus C over N times B. And if I aggregate that, I get the amount produced by the firm will be 1 half A minus C over B, which is the same as for a monopoly. So a competitive firm produces, industry produces the same as the monopoly, and industry output is independent of how many firms there are there. And does it make much difference? Well, if you're trying to maximise profits, the neoclassical formula gives you that level of profit. And if I solve how much profit that gives you, given those terms, I've got a nice little quadratic there, the correct formula says produce that much. If I feed that into profit maximising expression and solve for profit, I get that's the amount of profit being made. I can then subtract the two when n's greater than 1, and I get that expression. We get A minus C all squared, therefore a positive number. N plus 1 all squared on the bottom one, also a positive number. B, also a positive number. So my profit is going to be bigger than their profit. And the amount, when I choose that, the example I gave you beforehand, is that if they follow my formula, with 100 firms in the industry, on average the firms make 20 times as much profit. That sort of matters. And given that case, if you had Mr. Businessman getting the neoclassical advice, his reaction to the neoclassical economist, rather the mathematician, pardon me, first off, would be promote the mathematician, and for the neoclassical economist, he'd need to find another job. So, that's the state of the theory. I'll just save that animation.